Okay guys, so what we're going to do now, we're going to light the fire, or light our tinder bundle at least, using flint and steel. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take a lump of charcoal off. From my tinder pouch. And I'm going to remove a small piece of the jute. I'm then going to place the lid back on my tinder pouch, or my tobacco tin, to make sure that no moisture falls into the pouch. Okay, so those are my component parts. I have my flint, I have my steel, I have my charcloth, I've got a small piece of jute which I'll quickly tease apart. We call this an ember extender or a coal extender. The idea is this will just help the tinder bundle initially catch. And then I have my tinder bundle. Now at the moment, as I say, it's been raining for days and days and days, so everything's a bit damp. So anything that I can do to help me light my tinder bundle will obviously be greatly appreciated. Now I believe that this method, the tobacco tin or tinder pouch, was probably the favourite method of the outdoors person, purely for its simplicity or its ease of use. The tinder box, probably from lack of experience on my part, I find quite difficult. I don't like the striking down motion. This I find quite easy to do. Okay, so this is the technique that I would prefer to use, and I think that most guys moving into the wilderness would have adopted this method. So to work, to strike the spark then, we strike the steel against the sharp edge of the flint. To create an ember, once we've got the ember, we can transfer the ember to our tinder pouch, or sorry, to our tinder bundle. The colour of that smoke shows that the tinder is very, very damp. But there you go. Okay, so now I've got a fire. What I would now do is transfer this to my fireplace. I'd add my small kindling. I'd add my main fuel and start building up my fire. Bear in mind, guys, that small kindling or smule fuel, your kindling, would be matchstick, thick, arm-length twigs. Two bundles which we place crisscross over the top. We'd then go on to our small fuel, then our main fuel, building up the fire till we reach a point where we're ready to leave the fire and establish itself. We'll talk about fires and fire lays in another program, but for now, that's fire lighting, the flint and steel. Okay guys, what I have here is my tobacco tin, or tinder pouch, depending on what you want to call it, okay? I thought I'd just go through the contents again, so that any of you who are a little bit unsure can make sure you're aware of what everything is. Okay, so first and foremost, I've got my birch peelings. Now, these I would add to my tinder bundle, so that once the charcloth reached a hot enough temperature, it would ignite the birch peelings and thus assist the tinder bundle catching fire. Behind that, I have some charred material. This is partially charred, you can see, it's not fully 100% charred. And that's the stuff I was doing at the start of the last video, the first video. And I placed that in there. It's charred enough to catch a spark, but I can always add that to a flame just to char it a little bit more if I need to. My main source of charred material at the moment is just that little bit there, which is fully charred and is much better at catching the flame. I have a piece of flint, which is there, a shard of flint, and obviously my steel. This type of steel is a little round steel rather than a C-shaped steel, and I like it purely for its small size and the fact that it doesn't take up much room in the tin, which allows me to get bits and pieces in there. But a C-shaped steel or even a U-shaped steel would be quite at home in a tobacco tin. We have some amadou. This is the tremor layer of the horse's hoof fungus. We can either use the true tinder fungus or the false tinder fungus. If we're using a tinder fungus, generally speaking, we cut out the tremor layer, which is the spongy layer above the corky pores. We can then boil this in a lye solution, which makes it soft and durable and enables it to catch a spark. And then behind that, I have here some various bits of short lengths of string. There's some few bits of jute, and there's also a couple of bits of, I think that's hemp rope. As you saw before, that can be teased out, placed in a tinder bundle, and used as a cold extender. Okay, guys, so that is my tinder pouch, or tobacco tin. One last thing I want to talk about, guys. Some people will ask, why do we go, or why are we practicing old techniques when a flint and steel, when a fire steel or a match or a lighter is a much easier technique, a much easier way of lighting a fire, much more, in theory, guaranteed way of lighting a fire. My answer to that would be, the more primitive technique we practice, the more we're required to prepare the fire correctly. If we're using a bow drill, for example, we need to make sure that our tinder's bone dry, we need to make sure that we select the right woods for our half and our spindle, we need to carve those woods, we need to make sure that the dimensions are correct. So there's a lot of preparation that goes into it. With flint and steel, the same thing. It's a lighter fire with flint and steel, as you saw there. We need to make sure we've got a flint with a sharp edge. We need to make sure we've got a tinder bundle that's dry, or reasonably dry. We need to make sure we've got a combustible material, be that char cloth, be that amadou, be that charred punky wood, depending on what technique we're using. We then need to catch the spark or create the ember and blow that to a flame. People nowadays find it very easy to light fires with flint and steel where they're sparking onto a bit of birch bark. Great technique, there's still some preparation goes into it. Okay? But if we take a step backwards, we're always preparing. We're always preparing to succeed. One thing I did notice when I used to work for Woodlaw, Ray Mears' company, we could always tell the students when they came back on the journeyman courses or other courses who'd been on fundamental courses when the weather was wet. Because those were the guys who would take the dry standing deadwood from the branches of the trees. The guys who'd done courses where the weather was dry would be ones who looked on the floor. Okay? Simple thing like that can mean the difference between life or death if you come to light a fire in an emergency situation in bad conditions. And that's all the preparation is. Preparation is just getting you into the mindset so that you prepare everything 100% to succeed first time. If you succeed first time in an emergency, then you're going to save your life. Bearing in mind also, guys, with fire, fire gives us a means of purifying water, of cooking food, of signaling for help. It gives us a place. If we're lost or in an emergency situation, by lighting a fire, we have a place, we have a spot where we can feel secure, even if it's just for the night. If we can light a fire, we can survive a night just by sitting by the fire. It may not be the best night of our lives, it may not be the warmest, most comfortable night of our lives, but we could sit by the fire and survive the night and keep warm. If the temperature really drops, we could build two fires, and we could sit between the two fires. Obviously, that's going to use more energy, it's going to be more time consuming, we're going to have to gather more fuel, but we could survive the night. To enhance our fire, then, we'd build a shelter. And that's what we're going to look at in the next episode. We'll look at a couple of types of shelter building, the use of a tarpaulin or the use of a poncho to create shelters, and how to build a shelter from scratch.